morning, everyone.
Good morning.
My name is Harold Lung. I want to welcome you to First Alliance Church. Whether you're online or in person, we're glad that you're here. Special welcome to those of you who might be joining us for the first time. We are a church that values going deep in Jesus and reaching wide with his love. One of the ways that we like to do that is through small groups, which is a chance to go deep and connect small with other people who are following Jesus. If you're not plugged into a small group, you can go online to our church website at firstalliancechurch.org/smallgroups, and that's where you can join. For the last 2 weeks, we've been focusing on missions. And last week, Reverend Sundarkrishnan talked to us about the importance of prayer. The real battle takes place in prayer. And building on the foundation of prayer, today we will discuss being on mission with God. Before we get to that, I have a few announcements. The first is our new opening protocols. So even though we are more open, we still want everybody to be comfortable, so we have reserved one section of the sanctuary for physical distancing, on this side over here. We will still require masks to be worn at all times, and we will continue to monitor government guidelines and make changes as necessary. As the body of Christ, we ask all to be mindful of each other's comfort levels. Please respect those who want more physical space. Second announcement is, if you have 20 minutes to invest in praying for our community, I invite you to join us on Tuesday 29th from 12:30 to 12:50. There's a small group of people who have been interceding for this community and asking God for an outpouring of his spirit. Come join us online. If you want to get involved, you can contact the church office for the link. Scott Ruff, one of our elders, will be giving an announcement after the benediction, so I invite you to please stick around after that. Finally, we want to thank you, as always, for your generous giving. Your giving supports the work of First Alliance in this community. For those of you who are in person, at the end of the service, there will be an usher just outside these doors if you want to give that way. Alternatively, you can give online at firstalliancechurch.org/give. At this time, I'd love to hand it over to Abby and the worship team to lead us in worship.
Good morning. Good morning. It's lovely to be in God's presence together. And together in physically, together in spirit with those of you at home and online. And I just want to call us into worship with the words of Psalm 105. And I would welcome you to stand, if you are able, as we reflect on this scripture. From Psalm 105, give praise to the Lord, proclaim his name, make known among the nations what he has done. Sing to him, sing praise to him, tell of all his wonderful acts. Glory in his holy name, let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Look to the Lord and his strength, seek his face always. And we want to follow in obedience to that call to rejoice, to sing to the Lord, and to tell of his awesome acts. Would you join with us this morning?
Becoming his flesh. These are
passion, stand beside the heroes of the faith. With one voice, a thousand generations sing, worthy is the Lamb that was slain. And on that day, we join the resurrection, stand beside the heroes of the faith. With one voice, a
God in three persons.
Please be seated. As we go into a time of prayer, I'd like for us to continue to meditate on the holiness and greatness of our God. I want to read for us from Psalm 89. So I invite you to close your eyes and meditate on these words with me. Starting in verse 5, let the heavens praise your wonders, O Lord, your faithfulness in the assembly of the holy ones. For who in the skies can be compared to the Lord? Who among the heavenly beings is like the Lord? A God greatly to be feared in the council of the holy ones, and awesome above all who are around him. O Lord God of hosts, who is mighty as you are, O Lord, with your faithfulness all around you? You rule the raging of the sea. When its waves rise, you still them. Continuing verse 14, righteousness and justice are the foundation of your throne. Steadfast love and faithfulness go before you. Blessed are the people who know the festal shout, who walk, O Lord, in the light of your face, who exult in your name all the day, and in your righteousness are exalted. For you are the glory of their strength. By your favor, our horn is exalted. For our shield belongs to the Lord, our King, to the Holy One of Israel. God, we thank you that you reign. We thank you that you are holy, that you are pure, that you are light, and by you we see light. We thank you that though we were dead in our trespasses, through Jesus Christ who died on the cross for our sins and rose from the dead, we can have eternal life and hope. And Lord, we confess that we have fallen short of that glory, and that we continue to sin, Lord. We confess that we have not loved you with our whole hearts. We confess that we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. And we thank you, O Lord, that not only do we have forgiveness, but we have access to you, O God, our Father. And that you are a good, good Father who knows all our needs, who sees our suffering, who grieves with us. Lord, I pray for those of us who are going through sickness, loss of a loved one, financial difficulty, other health issues. Lord, I pray that you would be present with each and every one of them, that you would help them to know, to feel that you are there, to know that you love them, that you care for them, that you understand what they're going through, and that you will be their strength, you will be their light at the end of the tunnel, that you will bring them all that they need to endure. Lord, we think of Pastor Andrew and his family. Lord, continue to be with them and continue to strengthen Pastor Andrew. Lord, we pray for our city. We pray for Dave Burge with Youth Unlimited as he runs the weekly youth programs here in the FAC gym. Lord, we pray that you would provide more workers, that you would enable bold and fearless proclamation of the gospel message. And we pray, Holy Spirit, that you would work in the hearts of the youth to accept that message. Lord, we pray also for our nation. We continue to pray for strength and resilience for all healthcare workers, those battling COVID-19 in their bodies, and for those experiencing hardship and the lasting physical, social, economic, psychological, and spiritual effects of the virus and ongoing restrictions. Lord, we pray for peace in our country of Canada. Lord, we ask you for civility and mutual respect to prevail, that you would give government and leaders at every level wisdom and understanding, and that prudent decisions would be made for the public good of all Canadians. Lord, we continue to pray for peace in Ukraine and the political leaders in Europe and at the UN to be instruments of your peace. Lord, we ask for bold and effective witness of the church and its leaders in Ukraine as they and their congregations are suffering great loss while seeking to guide and serve those in their communities. Lord, we think of Neil and Ingrid, our international workers with SIM in Southeast Asia. Lord, we pray for Ingrid, who plans to volunteer at a physio rehab center in this new city of ministry that they're in. Lord, we ask that you would open up doors to knowing the local people. Lord, that you would cause this opportunity to work out well, that it would be fulfilling work for Ingrid, and that she will be able to bless people through her skills. And now, as our Lord Jesus taught us, we are bold as to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
My hero is my mom. Even though sometimes she doesn't understand how my sister works and can also be cold sometimes, she makes it up by never criticizing whatever new hobbies I start picking up. She's also the person that taught me how to ride my bike, and she also stayed with me when I used to play the piano. She'll stay with me for hours. And also when I started learning the ukulele, I would have to record me playing the song so many times, and it'll usually take hours. A lot of the time, I would make lots of mistakes, but she wouldn't mind and keep recording. At the end of the day, we'll record 50 or so recordings and pick out the best out of all of them. She can also be super strict and responsible, and would always yell at us and tell us to go to bed. Us as in also my dad. To be honest, the list goes on. I don't think she failed as being a mother to me. Just imagine, if kids graduate, they can also have the ceremony so kids can also give their parents a certificate for succeeding as being a parent.
Good morning, and thank you so much, Elise. So I ask you, who is your hero? Now that we can sit closer together, I'm going to ask you to turn to the person beside you, or if you're at home, you can talk to the people there, or maybe you want to put it online. Who is your hero, and why? I'll give you a minute to do that. Okay, thank you. We all have heroes. Heroes are usually someone who does something magnificent, something very noble. And in the case of Elise's mother, someone who perseveres and who loves her children and does everything she needs for them. I have many heroes myself, and today I want to tell you about one of my heroes. My favorite type of a hero is that underdog, the one who has a deficit. The one who you just don't think is going to amount to anything, and suddenly that person steps in and saves the day. Here's one of my heroes. Gladys Elward. She lived from 1902 to 1970. She was born into a British family, a working class family to say, and she didn't have much education. So by the time she was a teenager, she started working, and her job was to be what we would call in modern days a housekeeper, and this is what she did. The one thing about Gladys is that she did love Jesus, and she was really committed to his mission, and her life goal was to someday go to China and tell everyone there that she could about Jesus, to give them the opportunity to learn about him and make their own decision about whether or not they wanted to follow him. Couple of problems, though, regarding this goal that she had. There's a lot of things that stood in her way. First one was, she did not have the aptitude to learn the language. So she joined a mission organization, and a mission organization would be a group of people who would support these missionaries and would support them in numerous ways. They would help them to learn the language, they would take care of their health needs, they would make sure they have the right connections, and when they're on the field, they would help them with their mental health and anything like that. Well, when she joins this organization, she sadly finds out that they don't accept her. Because as much as they tried to teach her the language, she just couldn't learn. Okay, this didn't distract her in any way at all. She kept hoping that one day she would make it to China. And then the big day happened. She was so thankful. She finds someone who lives in China. This is an elderly woman who is working there and is looking for an apprentice because she herself wants to retire. So Gladys jumps on board, writes her a letter, gets accepted, and this is fantastic. She's going, but not so quick. There's more obstacles along the way. For you see, as I told you, Gladys came from a working family. It's not like she had a lot of money, and she certainly didn't have many connections. So she couldn't even afford the ticket to sail to China. So what does she do? She buys a train ticket that's going to take her across the land. Only problem is, at this particular time in history, Russia and China are in a non-declared war. Okay, she hops onto the train, has no idea what kind of danger she's in, and travels across. She runs into quite a bit of problems when she's in Russia. They take her passport, they doctor it and change it, and she soon finds out they're not going to let her go. Her dream to go to China is gone. But she does find out eventually that she needs to escape, and there are some people who help her. So she finally makes this long, 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 arduous journey, arrives in China. Her goal, her dream, not so great right away. She finds that she's in a hostile environment. People don't like her because she's talking about Jesus, and this is a foreign religion, so they want to have nothing to do with this. In addition to that, she herself is a foreigner, and they want to have anything to do with her either. So she's in this hostile environment. She doesn't give up. She talks, but what she says matches how she lives. She lives the message of Jesus with love and concern and compassion. And eventually, people start warming up to her, and they start to trust her. So some of the great things that she accomplished in her life, one of them was, one day, a government official shows up on her doorstep and tells her that she is the one who is going to go through rural China, through all the various villages, and ensure that families are abiding by the new rule that says that little girls' feet cannot be bound. She's the inspector, and she's going to go through China. Wow, what an opportunity. She's got a government entourage to help her, and off she goes. She ensures that this unjust practice ends in all the villages of China. This was a practice that basically rendered generations of females handicapped because their feet were bound from a young age and could not grow. Their bones would break and could not go properly, so that women were not able to walk properly, they definitely couldn't run, and they would be in constant pain. And as she walked through all these villages, she had access to these people, not only to make sure that they were abiding by this new rule, but she would explain to them why, and she would also introduce them to Jesus. There was another time when Gladys was, someone raps on her door and tells her that she has to go deal with a riot that has broken out in the prison. Now, this is a massive, massive riot where prisoners have gotten loose, and they're rampaging the prison. They're killing everybody off. The wardens, with their weapons, take off because they're so afraid, and they tell this tiny, tiny little person, you go in there and deal with this. And she does. She tells them all to be quiet, and they do. And then she talks to them and finds out what the issues are. She then initiates prison reform, which changes the entire way the prisons are run in that area of China, which makes it better not only for those prisoners, but for their families and for generations after that. One of the things that Gladys is most, most known for is something that happened in 1938 when Japan invaded China. At this time, she was running an orphanage, and she had about 100 children under her care. And she finds out that the enemy is coming closer, And not only are they coming closer, their target is her orphanage. So she realizes the imminent danger that she's in and that all the children in her care are in. So she packs up all these children and treks over the mountains of China on a 12-day journey to bring these children to safety. All those children's lives were saved. So you can see why she's my hero. She's someone that you would overlook. She was so ordinary. She had nothing going for her. And she comes along and leaves this legacy where she impacted the world for so much good. So many lives were changed because of her. Gladys was on mission with God. She loved him with all her heart and with all her soul, and she loved her neighbor as herself. Now, when we talk about missions, we're talking about an undertaking of an important task, a task that requires your attention, your focus, and your investment. It's definitely not that chore that's on your to-do list that you don't get around to, like cleaning the garage. You kind of think, I'll get to it when I get to it. That is not a mission, not at all. A mission takes, as I said, it takes intentionality. And in the Christian church, when we talk about mission, we talk about the mission of telling the world about Jesus with the hope and intent that they too will follow Jesus. And at this point in time, you may be thinking, whoa, this is problematic in our highly individualized society. We live in a I do me, you do you. Don't tell me about your religion. Okay. So it does become a problem. So what is it about Christians that we feel that this is so important that we tell the world about Jesus? If we really want to understand this, we really want to understand why mission is so important, we really need to understand that God is the missional God. And we find out about God's mission throughout the entire scripture, starting right at the beginning of Genesis. So if you follow me for the next 20 minutes or so, I'm going to look at several scriptures, and we're going to wrestle with this idea of mission and living a missional life. So in the very beginning of our Bible, we have the book of Genesis. In chapters 1 and 2, we read about the creation of the world. And right through those chapters, we read that everything is good. God created everything is good or very good. So this was a perfect world. All creation was in harmony with each other. And God and humanity had this great relationship. God would come down every day to the garden and talk to them, and they had this great relationship. Within this perfect relationship that God created, there was a hierarchy. God was up here, all of creation was down here. And rightly so, because God created it all. He should be up here, he should be in charge, and everything else is down here. No other part of creation had a choice about that, except humans. Humans were the pinnacle of God's creation and were given the whole world to take care of. But they were also given free choice. And eventually, as they're in the garden, they fall to the lie that Satan gave them, that somehow God is keeping something from us. And the Bible records that they say, yes, it would be good to be like God. So in other words, their thoughts were going from here to, yeah, it would be kind of good if I could be up here like God, sharing the divinity. What parent would allow their 2-year-old child to have as much autonomy and authority as they do over a family? Not likely. God's up here. He's the creator. And humans are doing this. Shove over. I can be up here with you. And God says, no. That's actually quite evil, to be able to reject God and want to be like God. And that is the fall of creation. And right there, at the very moment of the fall, we see God's mission. We see how he acts as a loving father to these wayward children. His heart is broken for them. And we see that because when they fall, a few things happen. Immediately, shame enters in. Fear enters in and blame enters in. So you can see automatically this perfect relationship is broken and all of a sudden these terrible things are happening. Adam and Eve suddenly felt shame. Shame that they had never experienced before. They had no idea what shame was before the fall, and now they were shamed. And what do? They go and gather some fig leaves together. Totally, totally insufficient way of dealing with their shame. Then that evening when God comes down, they're afraid, so they go and hide. And then when God starts talking to them, you notice they start blaming. Adam blames Eve, Eve blames the serpent. It's a terrible world. But even in that moment, when they had to leave, God recognizes that they've done a terrible job in trying to cover up their shame. So what does he do? He makes coats for them from skin. So you can see this is not a judgmental God. This is a father's heart who's completely broken at what they've done. And right there and then, his mission is to redeem them back, to bring them back to the pre-fall status. And we see that in Genesis 3:15. And if you have a Bible, you can look it up, or you can look it up on your device. And this is God giving a curse to Satan. He says, "And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head, and you will strike his heel." This is the first foreshadowing of the cross. Right there at the fall, when that perfect oneness was broken, God tells humanity, or foreshadows humanity, his mission to bring them back. When we jump over to the New Testament and we read in the Gospels the genealogy of Jesus, we see that Jesus' genealogy goes right back up to Adam and Eve. So we see that this offspring that God is talking about here is Jesus. And yes, the serpent being the devil strikes Jesus because Jesus submits himself and allows himself to be put on the cross. And what Satan thought was his greatest victory was actually his greatest defeat. Because through that action, Jesus crushes his head and defeats him. Jesus rises from the dead, and now death is defeated. And that was the way that all humanity can be restored. And that's God's mission, to restore humanity to the pre-fall status. And we see this right through the Old Testament. So much foreshadowing, so many prophecies that lead us to Jesus. And then we get to the New Testament, where we meet Jesus, and we see what he does. And in Philippians 2, verse 6, this is how the writer explains Jesus. Jesus, who being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking on the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in the appearance as a man. And he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. So we see here that Jesus, in fact, was the first missionary. He left his home in heaven. He left all that divinity. He left all that power. He left all that greatness to go to a foreign place that was hostile to him. And there he lived among the people. He loved the people. He taught the people about God. And he demonstrated the kingdom of God. He gathered a couple of people together. Well, not a couple, a few more than a couple. And they were his close companions. They were his disciples. And there were others involved in this group. And they followed him, and he taught them. He discipled them for 3 long years. And at the end, he dies and rises from the dead, and he meets them again. And this is what he says to them. "Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you to the very end of the age." This command is the command that's given to the church, because this was actually the first little church, those disciples. So Jesus is saying, "I am now passing the baton on to you. It is now your mission to go and make disciples of all nations." God is a God on mission. His desire is to bring us back to the pre-fall status, and he's entrusted the church to do that. And that command started immediately. Those followers of Jesus were actually quite timid and fearful. They were afraid of the Romans. So what they do is they go, and they're in this little room, and all the doors are locked, and they're there praying, and Jesus has told them, "Stay in Jerusalem until you receive the promise I'm going to send." And then lo and behold, the Holy Spirit falls upon them. And those fearful people all of a sudden become fearless. So what happens? They go outside, Peter starts preaching, and 500 people turn to Jesus. And then as they continue with their life, great things start to happen. They see miracles, they see healing, but then persecution arises. So because of this persecution, those small believers are now scattered to other places. And what happens in those other places? They start sharing the news. And then more people start turning to Jesus. And this keeps happening until it gets to the point in time where in Acts 13, the church decides to send Paul and Barnabas out with a special task. And their task now is to go out and establish new churches. And so you've got this missionary movement. And throughout the centuries, the church has had this formal and informal structures to raise up, train, send out, support missionaries to go abroad. And also at home, it's always been important for the church to go out and talk to people about Jesus, to show them that Jesus really wants to connect with us, really wants to bring us in closer to him, to have a loving relationship. Not to judge us, but to give us all that is good. And throughout the centuries, the church has done wonderful things in the realm of missionary work. Not only have people come to know Jesus, but other things have happened. The kingdom of God has been brought forth in so many areas. We can look over the world and see the legacy of some of the believers who've gone before us. We see hospitals that have been built. We see schools that have been established. We see unjust practices that have been done away with. We see generations of hatred experiencing reconciliation. But, and sadly this is a big but, the church has not always gotten it right. Sometimes, in the name of going out to share the gospel, the church has done some terrible things. And this is something we need to contend with in our generation. Right here in Canada, this is so true and applicable to us. When the news of 200 unmarked graves at the Kamloops residential schools shook our nation last year, and then more unmarked graves, we realize how sad and how horrible the involvement of the church had with residential schools. Can you blame a secular society when they see that, and then they see Christians trying to spread the word of Jesus, that they're hostile? When people who don't know about Jesus see Christians talking about Jesus and trying to see if people will be converted to Christianity, but then they see the behavior of the Christians and they gossip and they lie and they cheat, there's no difference between them and somebody else, they kind of say, oh, I don't want it. You can have it. When Christians are loveless and judgmental, who wants to hear that message? That message gets garbled. And because of the actions of the church and because of the actions of Christians, people then do not want to have anything to do with Jesus. And especially in our individualized society, people don't want it. So what do we do? Well, despite the animosity, the mandate of the church remains the same. We are still called to make disciples of all nations. Gladys Aylward showed up in a very hostile environment. Jesus, when he came to this earth, it was very hostile to him. And here we are in 2021 in a Canadian society where the church is no longer the center of society, where you can't assume, because 90% of the people ascribe to Christianity, there's many things you can assume, but you can't anymore in this society. How then does the church live a missional life? Well, the first thing is we have to recognize that missions is not something we do. If it's something we do, we can actually use our own skills, our own efforts, our own thinking, and at first it may look like we're doing something good, but it's not going to have lasting effects, and it's not going to be transformational. Sometimes the church could even get carried away with doing stuff that's gimmicks. Gimmicks! You know when someone calls you and says, come on, just come here, you get a free vacation. All you need to do is sit and listen to a presentation. A presentation. No, it's not a presentation. It's a two-hour, high-stress, demanding, pushing you to buy something. And if you buy it, they give you the vacation. If you don't, they make up an excuse and you don't even get the free prize. You quickly learn that gimmicks are not about you. They're about the person for an ulterior motive. And in the case, the example I just gave, it's to make money. Sometimes, sadly, in the church, it becomes about the Christian. I want to do this because I feel good about it. Because I can then say, I brought X number of people to Jesus. That's not missions. God is missional. It was who he was. It's an attribute of God. He can't but help to be missional. He wants us back in relationship with him. So to be missional living, it has to be the heartbeat of who we are. And if we do this, I think it's important for us to revisit another important scripture that we refer to as the Great Commandment. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is this: love your neighbor as yourself. Is not this the example of Jesus? Look at the relationship between Jesus and God. It was one of love and unity, perfect love and unity. Jesus always pointed to God. We can see in John 12:49 that Jesus says this when he's talking to people: for I have not spoken on my own authority. Instead, the Father who sent me has himself given me a command about what I should say and how to speak. Perfect oneness. Jesus was always in communion with the Father. The Father would speak to Jesus, and Jesus would give that message to us. And Jesus would do what the Father asked him to do. And out of this relationship, Jesus lived a missional life. Everywhere he went, he taught about the kingdom of God. Everywhere he went, he pushed back powers of darkness. He was invited to a wedding once, and so he's a guest at a wedding. And what does he do at that wedding? He changes water into wine. This was the first sign that talks and shows the people about the abundance of the kingdom of God. He ate with tax collectors. He talked to women. He even went out of his way to visit the despised Samaritans, only to deliver someone who was an outcast and despised by her community. He brought freedom to those who were captive. He gave sight to the blind. He raised people from the dead. Everywhere he went, this is who he was. He had that perfect oneness with the Father, and then he was on mission, and he just did all of this. It's not something he added on to his life, as though he has his to-do list. I do this, 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 and this. Oh, and oh, by the way, I need to do outreach. No, it's all of himself. It was all in him. This is what he did. And then if we move on in the New Testament, Paul tells us what this might look like. Now, Paul, in 1 Corinthians 9, is talking to the Corinthian church. So a little bit of a background about this. Paul had gone to the city of Corinth, and he established a church. And he raised leaders there, and he left them to go on their own, and he moved along. So the leaders were taking care of the church. After some time, he finds out that things are not going so good in that church. In fact, things are going terrible in that church. And so he writes a letter to them to talk to them about some of these issues. Some of the issues that these people were having was they were totally divided. Some people liked Paul. Some people didn't like Paul. Some people liked Apollos. Some people didn't like Apollos. So they were completely divided. They were having lawsuits against each other. And they were living in a way that even the sexually permissive environment that they were living in was abhorred at what they were doing. So their life was not matching what they were preaching. Not at all. In addition to this, they started to doubt Paul as a leader. And so he writes to them, and he talks about his apostleship and his right to be their leader and his right to be paid for what he's doing. But he says, I've put this all away. I'm not claiming my rights. And this is what he said. Though I am free, I belong to no one. I have made myself a slave to everyone, to win as many as possible. To the Jews, I became like a Jew, to win the Jews. To those under the law, I became like one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so as to win those under the law. To those not having the law, I became one like not having the law, though I am not free from God's law, so as to win those not having the law. To the weak, I became weak, to win the weak. I have become all things to all people, so that all possible means I might save some. I do all this for the sake of the gospel, that I may share in its blessing. So to be all things to all people, if that's my goal, then I am willing to lay down my privileges. We have many privileges in Canadian society. And as a legacy of a country where the majority of the population was Christian, some of these privileges are still here, but they're dwindling and they're going away. And sometimes Christians get upset about that. We have to remember, though, that these are privileges. For example, whether or not I say Merry Christmas or season's greetings is not bringing Christ into Christmas. Bringing Christ into Christmas is living a life submitted to Jesus Christ for 365 days of the year. That's bringing Christ into Christmas. But arguing whether or not I can say Merry Christmas is a privilege. I'm laying that down. If I'm willing to be all things to all people, I'm going to put my personal preferences aside. Maybe my preference is to be like people who are like me. Maybe my preference is to just hang around those who believe what I believe. If I'm willing to be all things to all people, I'm not going to use people for ulterior motives. I'm not going to try to manipulate people to come to Christ. I'm not going to use them so that I can pat myself on the back and feel good about myself. If I'm willing to be all things to all people, I'm definitely going to humble myself. And I'm going to apologize when I need to apologize. And I'm going to acknowledge that some of the criticism that the world has against the church has value. If I'm willing to be all things to all people, I'm willing to lay down my position of power. The person who gives is the person in power. The person who receives is the person who is not in power. Jesus came with all power and all authority, and he laid down his divinity, and he came as a servant. Am I willing to be a servant? If I'm willing to be all things to all people, then I'm willing to go beyond my comfort level. I'm willing to enter into the messiness of other people's lives. It's easy to give money to something, or it's easy to give up an hour and a half of my time to do something as outreach and then go back to my comfortable living. But am I willing to enter into the messiness of those people's lives? Am I willing to walk a mile in another person's shoes to understand their perspective? If I'm all things to all people, then I am willing to maintain the dignity of those that I serve. And if I'm all things to all people, I am definitely going to surrender to Jesus as King of my daily life, willing to say, to do, to give whatever he asks. This is missional living. We are surrounded by a cloud of witnesses who have gone before us, loving God with all their hearts, with all their souls, and with all their minds, and being on mission for Jesus. Look what one simple, yielded life did in the life of Gladys Aylward. A very simple, unconnected person was able to accomplish so much and so much good for the people that she didn't even know at first. When she was in England, she had no idea who these people were. They were strangers to her. What can we do as a church if we completely yield ourselves to Jesus? Not just in an hour when we're at church, but for the whole week. Every day of our lives, what can we do? I lost that slide there, but basically, you too can be a hero. You too can accomplish so much for Jesus if you're willing to lay your life down and completely yield to him. Our church has a mission prayer, a vision prayer. And actually, if we think about it, it's actually a very deep prayer. And it's a prayer of surrender. And it's a prayer of willing to allow ourselves to be put at the foot of Jesus for him to transform us in every way that he sees fit. So today I would like to end with this prayer. And I would like you that if you're willing to truly put yourself in a place of complete surrender to Jesus, for whatever, whenever he asks you that you're going to say yes, then you can pray this prayer with me. And if you're not ready, that's okay. Just don't say the prayer with us. And you can also say it in your mind if you feel more comfortable. So today we're going to end off with this prayer. Oh God, make us a body of people so transformed and empowered by your word and your spirit that our community, nation, and world will see and know Jesus Christ as the way, the truth, and the life. Amen. Thank you.
We invite you to stand with us as we respond, and just ask God to renew that desire in us to know him and make him known.
Thank you.
offer your benediction, I would say, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. Go in peace. I ask you now to sit down for a special announcement brought to us by Scott Ruff.
Good morning. Well, as mentioned, my name is Scott Ruff. I'm one of the elders here at First Alliance. I'm bringing this announcement on behalf of Catherine Thompson. She's the chairperson of the Board of Elders and unfortunately is not able to be here in person this morning, and on behalf of the board. So I'll be reading this. Thank you to all who participated in the recent candidate week and provided feedback to the Board of Elders regarding Reverend Paul Woodburn. The Board of Elders met yesterday for prayer and to carefully review all the feedback received. I'm pleased to inform you that during yesterday's meeting, the board voted unanimously to extend the call to Reverend Paul Woodburn to come to First Alliance as our lead pastor. As a board and as a church, we have been praying through this search process, and Reverend Paul and his wife Anna have also been praying for God's leading. The board will provide you another update on this very soon. We want to acknowledge that this is another change for us here at First Alliance, and for some, this change may be difficult. We invite you to continue trusting God that He has and will continue to provide for First Alliance. We also encourage you to continue to pray for Pastor Tim as he prepares for his new role at a new church, and for Pastor Andrew as he takes this time off. Thank you, and have a great week.